shalt purge me. O Lord, with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Thou shalt wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Have mercy upon me, O Lord, after thy great goodness. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost,
as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Thou shalt purge me, O Lord, with hyssop, and shall be clean. Thou shalt wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow.
O Lord, hear thy mercy,
and grant us thy salvation.
O Lord, hear my prayer,
and let my cry come unto thee. With thy Spirit.
O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, everlasting God, you who speak and hear us, thou sayest to them, I will bring angels from heaven, guard, cherish, protect, and visit, evermore defend all who are assembled in this place, in Christ our Lord.
Amen.
By my own fault, by my own most grievous fault. Wherefore, day, Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, Blessed Michael, the Archangel, Blessed John the Baptist, the Holy Apostles, Peter and Paul, all the angels and saints, and thee, Father, pray for me to the Lord our God.
Amen.
Amen.
That
thy people may rejoice in thee, and grant us thy salvation. And let my cry come unto thee.
God is in his holy habitation. It is he that maketh brethren to be of one mind in a house.
He will give the dominion and preeminence unto his people.
Let God arise, and let his enemies be scattered.
Let them also that hate him flee before him.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. God is in his holy habitation. It is he that maketh brethren to be of one mind in a house. He will give the dominion and preeminence unto his people.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy Spirit.
Let us pray. Almighty God, unto whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee, worthily magnify thy holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ said, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. The second is like unto it, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets.
Thank you.
Mary, and Joseph did consecrate in order of earthly battle. Rather, we, being enlightened by the example of their life, received in that holy family, and assisted by their prayers, may at last be joined with them in my eternal fellowship, with us and reigning with the Father in the unity of the Holy Ghost, ever one God, world without end.
Amen. Amen.
Thanks be to God.
One thing have I desired of the Lord, which I will require,
even that I may dwell in the house of the Lord,
to behold the fair beauty of the Lord,
and to visit his temple.
The Lord be with you.
and with thy Spirit.
Glory be to thee, O Lord.
The parents of Jesus went to Jerusalem every year at the feast of the Passover. When he was 12 years old, they went up according to custom. Parents did not know it. Supposing him to be with the company, they went a day's journey. They saw him among their kinsfolk and acquaintances. They did not find him. They returned to Jerusalem, seeking him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. And all who heard him were amazed at his understanding and his answers. When they saw him, they were astonished. His mother said to him, "Son, why have you treated us so? Behold, your father and I have been looking for you anxiously." He said to them, "How is it you sought me? Did you not know that I must be in my father's house?" They did not understand the saying. He went down with them and came to Nazareth and was obedient to them. And his mother kept all these sayings in her heart. And Jesus increased in wisdom and in stature and in favor with God and man. The gospel of the Lord. Some of the stuff that I've read over the past 2 years and
say what you say, if you've ever read that, because what you say contradicts what God says. You know, it is truly simple. Genesis, the first book of the Bible. Chapter 1, the first chapter of the first book of the Bible. Male and female, God created them, He blessed them, and says to them, be fruitful and multiply. I'm not the sharpest knife in the drawer. There are a lot of you guys out there that are a lot smarter than me, but guess what? That's pretty direct, you know? Yeah, just me. Male and female, God created them, and He blessed them. That is how families start. This is right. This is the creation story. He creates all this good stuff, light, darkness, animals, water, and land, all this stuff. And then He wants families established. And He says, this is how they start, male and female. Nothing said. Well, in our day and age, so what? So what? It's not a family. But nothing. It's not a family. Chapter 2. Therefore a man leaves his father and mother and cleaves to his wife, and they become one flesh. Sort of driving the point home. Again, very explicitly, very succinctly. I don't see one but in there. I don't see that in the future. You're going to understand that this means a whole. It's not there. No need to reinvent the wheel, as I said. Whatever the command is. Honor your father and mother, that your days may be long. Talk about the days of parents, how they are their descendants thing. Honor your father and mother, that your days may be long. That is the first commandment that there's a promise attached to. First commandment where there's a promise. Every other one, make the deal with God. Love the Lord your God with all your soul, mind, keep the Sabbath, use the word in anything. Don't promise you anything for that. Promise you something God or your father in love. A little quick note on that. That's not for little children. Okay? I don't know how many times I have stood around adults that look at a 3 or 4 year old. The commandment says you honor your father and mother. Moms and dads, check this one out. If they're 4 or 5 years old, you make them honor you. Alright? That's your job. If you don't do it, you are tremendously remiss in your responsibilities. You make little children honor you. That is not for little children. That's for adults. It says how we should always treat our parents. Make that word honor too. Why is it said, oh, it sounds so much more pleasant and emotional if we said, love your father and mother, or respect your father and mother? You know why it doesn't say that? Because God knows what He's doing. And if it said, love your father, love does not necessitate respect or reverence. You know, there are people in my own life that I love very dearly. I do not respect the way they live their life, and hence I cannot revere them. So I love them with all my heart, but I don't respect or revere them. And it doesn't say respect because you can respect people and not necessarily love. Okay? I'm a history buff. Makes me a comp. I respect a lot of people for a lot of things they've done or can do in this story. I don't love them. I respect them. When it says honor your father and mother, honor is heartfelt. If honor is heartfelt, it will necessarily involve love and respect and reverence. Can't help it. That's why the Holy Spirit says honor your father and mother. And then we have that reading from Colossians, the second reading for today. The Holy Spirit speaking through St. Paul. He gives us rules for Catholic households. And you know what? There's not this long list of page and page of like a first thing that it says, wives, be subject to your husbands as is fitting in the Lord. What? What? Look at the 21st century. I'm not subject to our Lord Jesus Christ, the second person of the Trinity, God Almighty Himself, can be subject to an earthly man or woman. What height of arrogance is it for anybody in this world to say, I won't be subject? Okay? And from a practical standpoint, there is nobody ever in this society anyway that ever holds a gun to the back of a woman's head and says she needs to engage in a Catholic parent. Alright? Nobody is forced anymore to do that here. Alright? You do it voluntarily. I do start marriage counseling. Well, I don't have to say that obey stuff. No, you don't have to. And I don't have to do your wedding either. You find a lot of Catholic priests who will, because there's a liturgy, isn't it? Well, we don't use that one. Oh yeah, we use that bomb to do it. They have the right to get married in the church. That's right. And I have the right to preach to you in the weddings that I want. Alright? That's all there is to it. At the wedding, and people are visiting, that's part of this whole thing. Why? Because God says it. Be subject to your husbands as is fitting in the Lord. Well, what about in Ephesians, another place where Paul talks about this, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. So you guys got that mortality thing tacked on to yours. It doesn't say anything about wives. Deal with your wives when you're up. It does say other people. So who's getting the short end of the stick on that? Alright? Let's not get all bent out of shape about that. Just do what God said. And things will work out perfectly. It says, children, obey your parents in everything. Children, obey your parents in everything. That is what the Lord wants. It says actually it pleases the Lord when you do that. Which would mean on the other side of the coin, if you didn't obey your parents and everything, that would displease the Lord. Fathers, do not hold your children, lest they be disturbed. There are parameters for Catholic households. Because there are parents and children, but I want to. Because everybody starts out as a child. So, and this is where it gets practical, because I don't want to expound too much on the owls and all this. Okay, just do what it says. How children are supposed to live with their parents. And again, that doesn't stop. Well, I'm 18 now. I'm out of the house now. Children, obey your parents, respect them, honor your father and mother. Why? It's not wrong to ask God. All right, sometimes you get answers, sometimes you don't. You get answers to this. Why? Why should children honor their parents? Foundation. Because they are the picture of your origin. They are from where you came. All right, that's all there is to it. God in His providence used them to bring you into this world. You received existence through them. God made use of them biologically, to infuse a soul into your life. So quit it up. You do not get your soul from your parents. Alright? A half dad soul, half mom soul. Alright? That's not Catholic. God fix it. Use that to make it better. So even the negative can be something positive. Catholics are the only people who can make something positive out of everything, including death, as I always say. Okay? You know, in many, our parents are human, they are frail, beset by living in a fallen world. That's neither here nor there. I mean, there are some very positive things. In many cases, your parents led you to the sacraments. In many cases, parents do. As soon as you could get them in here after they were born, baptism, immersion along. If they were confirmed, they started to make decisions of their own. Right? What you should have your face before Almighty God in your parents led you to the sacraments. Tremendous thing. And most parents do. Well, I wasn't raised in a Catholic. If there was a cross in your house, a tabletop Bible, something that just was there, that is a leading factor. And most people have something like that going on. Christmas. You know, here we are in the option of Christmas. You know, every pagan in the world is off of work and exchanging presents. Alright? That's believing in the things of the faith made connections. Your parents do things like that. Maybe you should be thankful for it, you should honor it. And it does not stop when you leave the house. As a matter of fact, as life progresses, it's more important. Because that's when the magic comes into the fore. And when we honor our parents as they grow older. They get protected. Especially if they weren't what they should have been. They weren't the pinnacle of the faith. They couldn't provide what you wanted to. They are still your parents, and your honor for them as they grow older, particularly if they weren't what they should have been, shows that you're doing what God says. When they die, well, I don't have to worry about it anymore. Both my parents are gone. Guess what? Offer masses for them. Have masses celebrated for their intentions. Pray for them and their souls in your rosaries and in your private devotions. Do them favors on the other side. That's what this is about, honoring your father and mother. Because you know what? If you do that, as your parents grow older, your kids, they may be adults, they're seeing the respect that you get. And you're an example for them. So this is kind of, you scratch my back, I'll scratch your thing. You do the right thing by your parents, and they will do the right thing by you because they've seen an example. That's a duty of children, parents. Duties of parents and children. First and foremost, and I mean this in this order, the knowledge and practice of the true religion. That means the Catholic faith. Alright? You as Catholic parents, we live in a time in history where a couple times that where we need to individually know our faith. You as parents, grandparents, great-grandparents, you need to teach your children the Catholic faith. They need to be bold in their presentation of the Catholic faith. Because there are a whole lot of adults in our day and age who aren't bold for the presentation of the Catholic faith. I have a great sense of sight. Give me grade 6 of sliced bread. If there was a little kid, 5 or 6 years old, who was leaving to go to Mass, and maybe their neighbors are getting ready to go to a service somewhere, they would look at them, where are you going? Oh, we're going to, where do you go to church? Well, first this and that, or, you know, whatever. Long name. You have the time. The rivers of life. Water of water. Community church. That's not a church. That's not Catholic. I'd love to see little kids say that. That's what we should strive for. They should be proud. They are Catholics. You know what it doesn't do? You shouldn't live in the middle. Well, you should live in the middle shrine. But I mean, you do have to also present them with regulation and rules for temporal life. You need to get them ready. If you can't shield your children too much from the world to where bad things can happen once they are exposed. You need to kind of inoculate that word after. If you do the first thing, teaching them the true faith, practice a good religion, then they are going to consequently live their lives according. If you are their examples, parents are, I don't have any kids. If you are in authority over everyone, and by virtue of just being a Catholic, guess what? You've been given a great commission to shine Christ's light in this world, to be salt and light. You are an example to somebody, somewhere, just by virtue that you show up here. And they know you're a Catholic, you wear a crucifix, whatever. But I mean, even more so for parents of biological children or adopted children, you are their examples of justice, chastity, modesty, holiness. You are their examples for that. You know? And it doesn't stop. Well, I don't really have to worry about that because they're out of the house. I hope to God, just because your kids do, doesn't mean your faith stagnates. Alright? Be great for some adult children. Bringing your grandchildren into the house, maybe they haven't been there for a couple of years, because they live out of state, and they walk in and there's a holy water font and they've never been there before at the front door. What is this, a church now? Yes. It shows that you are still progressing in faith. You are still an example. And you don't stop correcting. Yeah. You have kids that aren't living in conformity with the church. Don't beat them over the head with stuff. Don't shut everybody down. But you do need to point it out. That's our job. Right? There's got to be balance. Right? God asked that I settle me into a little bit. And this is for you guys. Fathers, do not provoke your children unless they become discouraged. Dads, you do have a role. You are the head of the household. That means you are the head. That old cliche, wait till your dad gets home. Now, I know a lot of moms that can take care of business themselves. They don't need to wait till dad gets home. Alright? But that is dad's job, to be the head. Because you need mom to be there when dad gets done. People on tape. Alright? Dad's up to your job. So you have to do it in balance. You cannot be over severe. If you are too severe with your children, it can result in bad things. They can grow up and be abject. I don't use that term a whole lot, but be self-abasing, down on themselves, no self-respect, they can be fearful of everything. You know, I can't do anything right. That kind of stuff. You don't want that. I mean, you can beat anything, literally and figuratively. In a submission, you don't want that. Well, people do things because it's the right thing to do. Now, there are times, they're rough, spoiled child. But again, balance. You don't want to be too severe. Nor do you over want to go to all the kids. Yeah, don't be too severe. Don't overindulge them either. Don't overindulge. You will turn them into spoiled brats. Alright? Good Bible story in the Old Testament about somebody who raised two spoiled brats. And he was a priest. Cain was his name. He had two sons and they were priests too. This is the depth to where overindulgence. His two sons who were priests used to take advantage of women who brought gifts to the temple. That's it, real loud and fair. They used to steal things that were given to the temple for the glory of God. You know, how low does it get? Right? And God told Haley through the prophets, you need to get a grip on your son. Oh, yeah, what will we do? Okay. Well, there's a battle between the Philistines again. And both of his sons are killed. And the Ark of the Covenant, they were attending, got taken by the enemy. Well, they come back and they tell Haley that this has happened. Kind of weird about it. When they tell him his two sons are killed, there's not really an overreaction. But when they say that the Ark of the Covenant, and he was taken because of those actions of his sons and him, it was taken, and in the older version, I love the older versions, they're much more up in your face, it said he was old and fat. When he heard the ark not taken, he fell out of his chair and broke his neck and died. That's what happens when you're overindulgence. You don't want to be overindulgent. It ends up in this. We as parents, and it doesn't mean it's biological, but in most cases, you want a desire to leave your kids up, right? Every parent wants to meet their children something. Unfortunately, in our day and age, what is that? When we hear inheritance, what is that? What pops to mind? Community. Stolen inheritance. think the only thing that God wants is for you to get to heaven. If you do that by conforming to his will, all right? That's what we want for our kids. We want them to go to heaven. I know a man who lost a child. He's an adult, young adult child. He's got six other kids. And he was leaving his son's funeral. And one of his aunts said, I can't do this so long. He goes, why? He goes, I got one into heaven, I got six others that he was worried about. That's the mentality that you should have. That is being pious. Again, I love the older stuff because it still is. It's not muddled, it's not ambiguous. Speaking of leaving kids an inheritance, the Roman Catechism says this. It is about parents who leave stuff to their kids instead of purity of religion. I quote the Roman Catechism that is as authoritative today as it was when it was written. Instead of bequeathing wealth to their children, they leave them rather their own wickedness and crimes for an inheritance. And instead of conducting them to heaven, leave them to be eternal torments of hell. Wow. That's not the church used to be. You should tell them to be able to directly talk about that. But as I just said, it is as true today as it was in the dream. That is that important. It is that great condition. We want to leave our kids staying beautiful and allow the scripture to apply to us. And they apply to us, not when we get to heaven, but right here and right now. And when it says at the end of that second reading today, the Holy Spirit says to St. Paul, of a law put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. If you look at your family the way we just discussed, if you live that way, if you do it in love, not just because, it binds everything together in perfect harmony, both in this life and in the next.
Father, Father, Almighty,
Maker of
or any other river. And we also bless thy holy name for all thy servants to part with life and thy faith and fear. You see, may you be merciful and grateful and joy in my love and service, and grant us grace to follow the good example of the Blessed Virgin Mary, of St. John, and of all thy saints, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant these our prayers, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our Mediator and Advocate, who we meet in the Holy Ghost, be all honor and glory.
Lord,
might be delivered from the bondage of sin and receive power to be God of thy children. Therefore, with angels and archangels, in all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, thank you. Never, Lord, dwell at rest in Christ, we seek to grant the abode of refreshing, light, of sinners all, of service. With open multitude of thy mercy, I say to grant the heart of fellowship with thy holy apostles and martyrs, John, Stephen, the Pius, Martinus, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and with all thy saints. Within his fellowship we beseech thee of it. Not waiting our merit, granting us forgiveness. In Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom, O Lord, thou hast ever created all these good things, thou sanctify, quicken, bless, and show. By whom, and with whom, and in whom, to the O Father Almighty, in the unity of the Holy the all honor and glory throughout all ages, world without end.
Sins.
Thee sorrowing.
And he said unto them, How is it that you sought me? Know ye not that I must be about my Father's business?
Thank you.
To be with God the Father, thy Spirit. Glory be to thee, O Lord.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was God. Same as in the beginning, God, all things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the light was the light of men. The light shined in the darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. The man said to God, his name was John. Same thing were with him, which was light. All men through whom I believe. He was not that light, and sent to bear witness to that light. That was the true light, the light of every man.